the beginning, there was darkness. And then, bang. Giving birth to an endless expanding existence of time, space, and matter. Every day, new discoveries are unlocking the mysterious, the mind-blowing, the deadly secrets of a place we call the universe. Warp speed. Transporters. Wormholes. And laser blasters. Science fiction concepts. But are they grounded in reality?
Is there life out there? The answer is yes.
Now, the next generation of physicists work to rewrite the cosmic rulebook.
I can't necessarily limit myself by the physics we know today.
And what seemed futuristic just decades ago may be coming soon to a planet near you.
Someone traveling close to the speed of light can effectively jump into the future.
Next stop, tomorrow. Arriving today as we explore the worlds of science fiction and science fact. Science fiction explores new life, new civilizations, and galaxies far, far away. The fantastic future of flying cars and laser beams still seems like a shimmering mirage of a tomorrow that never came.
Roads? Where we're going, I think we'll still need some roads.
But then there are those sci-fi technologies which may be arriving sooner than you think. Running late for an appointment? Stuck in traffic? Science fiction has the answer for your transportation problems. Simply beam from point A to point B.
The Star Trek transporter is one of those things that any of us who do a lot of flying really wish would just please be invented. But then when you start thinking about the technologies required, it becomes a bit daunting.
On Star Trek, as we've depicted it on the show, the transporter works by taking a person apart, atom by atom, converting those atoms into a stream of energy, beaming that energy to the target location, and then reassembling all of those atoms that make up the person at the target location.
As they're scanning the person, they're recording the positions of all the atoms, of all the electrons orbiting the atoms, of the spins of all of the electrons, the wave functions of all of the molecular structures in the body, how everything's vibrating, moving, the velocities. The amount of data is enormous. And somehow they're scanning all of it remotely, and then they're somehow taking and tearing that body apart.
The amount of energy required to turn a human into pure energy would be far more than in the most powerful nuclear weapons that humans have ever made. The process itself would be destructive.
To convert someone my size entirely to energy would be the equivalent 41 times the energy release of the largest nuclear weapon ever exploded on planet Earth. I mean, if you tried to transport me right now, you have to ask yourself.
But what comes out the other side of a transporter beam? Is it you? Or a perfect quantum replica of you?
Are they disassembling the person and reassembling them? Or are they disassembling the person, storing the information, and recreating the person from scratch?
It's an interesting question. Does the transporter actually kill you and then create a clone, or does it somehow preserve you and transport you to another place?
If you're going to say that you're disassembled atom by atom, converted into an energy stream, and then reassembled someplace else, I don't see how that's anything other than killing you and resurrecting you.
It may be a device rooted in science fiction, but the real-world prospects for transporter technology attracted the attention of the U.S. military. The Air Force commissioned a study to investigate the future of matter transmission systems and, not surprisingly, found a number of roadblocks.
Developing a working transporter is a tough nut.
Among the biggest? A problem you may have struggled with on your home computer. Not enough hard drive space. Forget megabytes or gigabytes. The information created by a scan of just one person would generate billions of terabytes.
One person would take roughly enough terabyte drives worth of storage to fill 500 million Empire State Buildings.
And an implication of storing a person as data is, do you have to teleport them immediately? What if you dematerialize them, store the information, and save it for 50 years, 100 years, 5,000 years? From the point of view of that person, it becomes time travel.
If hard drive capacities continue to improve at their present rate, a drive capable of handling the storage requirements may exist in about 200 to 300 years. A final barrier to creating a matter transporter is a fundamental property of quantum physics, known as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle.
After the original Star Trek premiered, a lot of physicists questioned the transporter technology, and one of the biggest problems with it that they talked about was that it's really not possible to know with complete precision both the location and the momentum of an atom or a subatomic particle.
In other words, the more you know where something is, the less you know how fast it's going, and vice versa.
If you take a picture of the merry-go-round, well, you can certainly see where that merry-go-round is with respect to anything else that's nearby, but the things that are spinning on the merry-go-round are kind of blurred.
If you're trying to reassemble the bits and pieces that make up a quantum image of a just dematerialized Captain Kirk, the last thing you want is Heisenberg's quantum uncertainty.
In Star Trek The Next Generation, one of our technical advisors, Mike Okuda, came up with the idea of this thing called the Heisenberg compensator, which is the component in the transporter that conveniently deals with that little problem. And I always thought that was a very clever solution to one of the biggest obstacles in building a transporter. The transporter would on occasion break down, and that was generally not good for the person being transported.
If some data were lost during transport and you ended up without eyes or a brain or something, that would obviously be disastrous.
You might lose a bit from your DNA, and while your body has DNA repair mechanisms, that repeated numerous times could lead to cancers, it could lead to deformities, it could lead to all sorts of maladies that you really probably wouldn't want to deal with.
Massively huge supercomputers, Heisenberg compensators, quantum scanning, all part of science fiction. So how do we make it science fact? By getting a little spooky. Einstein famously called it spooky action at a distance. It's the bizarre world of quantum entanglement.
Basically, two particles can interact in such a way that when they become separated, the state of one directly affects the state of the other. And using this property of entanglement, you can manipulate one location to change what's going on in the other location instantaneously.
This is about the single freakiest thing to come out of quantum mechanics. There's no way for the information to travel from the one particle to the other. You can separate them by so much that even the speed of light doesn't allow the information to get from one point to the other when you make the measurement. There's probably three people on the entire planet that fully understand this concept, and the rest of us just look at the mathematics and get queasy.